You're listening to The World at 8 with Lynn Mozar. The World at 8, the number one in nationalist news.
Highlights of the news today, Friday, the 22nd of March. Another foreign-owned plant rises on British soil. Channel 4 to celebrate Ramadan. Would you buy a Bentley built in Bratislava, Slovakia? Sharia about to enter Spanish legislation. Cyprus bank account looting could blow up Europe. Nick Griffin, MEP, from the belly of the beast. Has Syria become a chemical war? There's more to Islamic sex than husbands and his dead wife's corpse. Thought for the day, molehills, which have become mountains. And finally, with this force, I thee wed. UK news. Another foreign-owned plant rises on British soil. As the government gives green light to the new nuclear plant, we learn Energy Minister Ed Davey told Parliament he was granting planning consent for French energy plant EDF to build a new nuclear power station at Hinkley Point in Somerset, South West England. The proposed £14 billion power station would be capable of producing 7% of Britain's electricity, enough to power 5 million homes, EDF has said. It is estimated the project will create between 20,000 and 25,000 jobs while it is being built and 900 permanent jobs once it goes into operation. World at 8 believes most of these jobs will benefit European and third world migrants and not the British. What happened to the ability of the British to build our own nuclear power plants? It's just more and more of our industries being given over to foreign investment to reap both the short-term and the long-term profits. It's just more British money going out of the country with no real return. Channel 4 to celebrate Ramadan. Radio Times. Channel 4 is planning to broadcast Islamic morning prayers as part of a season of programmes celebrating Ramadan. Jay Hunt, the channel's chief creative officer, told journalists, "This is something no other channel would do." The month-long religious observance takes place during July and August and sees Muslims fasting and offering an increased number of prayers and recitations. A spokesman was unable to confirm whether it will be the first time a daily prayer service has been broadcast on Channel 4. Other programmes in the Ramadan season will include Do You Speak English?, looking at the 1 million immigrants in the UK who cannot speak the language, and a film that talks to Muslims about the physical and spiritual consequences of fasting during the holy month. World at 8 says, why not show a few suicide bombings, a clip on female genital mutilation, beheading, torture, amputation, persecuting Christians, war, poverty and death, just to remind them what their so-called prophet really called for. Would you buy a Bentley built in Bratislava, Slovakia? The Daily Mail revealed that Bentley's German chief, Dr. Wolfgang Schreiber, announced at their annual results conference in Luton that they were considering manufacturing Bentley's first sports utility vehicle, SUV, in the Slovakian capital in Eastern Europe. Bratislava and crew are now in competition to build up to 4,000 of the 150,000 4x4 SUVs a year, with the final decision to be made within weeks, they said. Hundreds of new jobs are riding on the outcome. Should Bratislava be chosen, the vehicle would become the first volume-produced Bentley to be built outside of the UK in the company's near 100-year history. It could not carry the plate that has adorned Bentleys for generations, made in Crewe, England. Bosses insisted it would still have Bentley DNA, but admitted the plaque would likely be altered to read "Designed in Crewe, England." European news. Sharia about to enter Spanish legislation. Intereconomía on the 5th of March reported the Spanish government will allow Moroccan religious authorities to take control of children up to 18 years to make sure they have not been converted to Christianity. The name Sharia is applied to the set of rules which govern the life of Muslims. The Islamic states are adopting it as their own legislation. Even countries in the Islamic world which are not Islamic states are adopting it partially. In the Spanish case, it is about the issue of adoption. It appeared in the press some days ago. It seems that many Spanish couples want to adopt children from abroad. It seems that there are not enough children there. The issue is that since the Islamists came to power in January 2012, Moroccan authorities demand that Moroccan children being adopted by Spanish families remain culturally and religiously Muslim. In addition to this, the Spanish government must take the responsibility for controlling this process and must allow Moroccan religious authorities to have control over those children until the age of 18 in order to make sure they do not convert to Christianity. World at 8 states, I thought the process of adopting children from the third world was to give them a better start in life and for them to adopt the culture of the family they would be living with for the next foreseeable future. I am frankly against taking children from one culture and religion to another, and it should be stopped. A Spanish Catholic couple taking on an Arab Muslim child, disaster. Cyprus bank account looting could blow up Europe. InfoWars reports PIMCO CEO Mohamed El Arian told CNBC Today that the decision to loot the bank accounts of Cypriot savers could blow up Europe and lead to civil unrest across the continent. El Arian said that the European Union had lit two sticks of dynamite in backing a proposal that could see bank accounts raided for up to 15% of their value in what has ludicrously been described as a wealth tax, yet amounts to nothing less than an act of wanton financial plunder. By including small depositors, they are risking social unrest, political disorder, and potentially an exit from the Eurozone, said El Arian, referring to people with under €100,000 who will still be hit by the levy of 6.75% under current proposals. Savers with €500,000 in the bank face losing as much as €75,000. The worst outcome is that you get complete political breakdown, social unrest, and then Cyprus is forced to exit, said El Arian, added that the move had accelerated the journey to disorder, which could lead to more countries exiting the Eurozone. I now hand you over to Nick Griffin, MEP, for his Friday report from the belly of the beast.
There's really only one piece of news worth discussing from Brussels this week. The Eurobeast's plan to fill its belly through a smash-and-grab bank raid on savings accounts in Cyprus. As a general rule, financial news is something that appears on the inside pages of the broadsheet newspapers and makes little or no impact on the thoughts, worries or discussions of most ordinary people. For example, the state-sponsored privatisation theft of most of our school buildings, playgrounds and playing fields, a looting spree that's handed billions of pounds worth of British property over to a list of private companies headed by some of the biggest financial backers of the Tory party, has been carried out almost unnoticed. But the Cyprus stunt is so outrageous that it's different this time. I was in a garage workshop the other day, and the mechanics, several very varied customers, and the girl on reception were all talking about it. The kleptocrats really have made the most monumental blunder here. Everybody understands how wrong this one is. Everyone now gets it. Everyone knows and fears that one day the same kind of ruthless folly, ugly greed and naked desperation will hit them. When you have a ruling elite that thinks like that, it's only a matter of time. As I record this, the denouement of the crisis is still undecided. It could end in the complete collapse of the Cypriot banking system, which has already been locked down for a solid week and is now not due to reopen until next Tuesday, with there being talk already of some banks never opening again. Although Cyprus is only small, such a disaster would surely be contagious, as well as risking revolutionary discontent among a whole people robbed of their savings. At the other extreme, the Europhiles could blink and come up with another bailout financed by Germany, in which case Angela Merkel would lose the forthcoming German election, and the EU elite would lose all credibility if they ever try to play the bad cop again. The third outcome, somewhere in the middle, would be a fudge, with the account holders only being partly robbed and the multi-billion black hole only partly filled, in which case everyone's a loser and things can only get worse. Or better, from the point of view of those of us who want to see the whole rotten pile of corruption and tyranny swept away into the litter bin of history. Whichever scenario pans out, the critical damage has already been done. In one truly foul swoop, the Europhiles have managed to destroy popular trust in the entire banking system, because everyone now knows that all the assurances about their deposits being guaranteed to be safe are utterly worthless So every time there's a bank liquidity scare anywhere in Europe from now on, we'll be back to scenes of panic like we saw when they were queuing round the block at Northern Rock. The move was so incredibly damaging that one has to consider the serious possibility that this wasn't a piece of monumental stupidity, but rather a deliberate ploy to destroy the banking system of the tiny state of Cyprus. Why might the Europhiles want to do that? Some have suggested it was an attack on Russia, but since most of the Russian money deposited in Cyprus has been stolen from Russia, often evading taxes, and since the EU's brutal handling of the crisis has helped to drive Cyprus, and by extension Greece, closer to Russia, it's hard to read it all as an attack on Russia. So if you want a more credible reason for the Europhiles deliberately trying to destroy Cyprus, here's my provisional analysis. When the Europhiles created the one-size-fits-all single currency, they knew it would lead to a crisis. That was the whole idea, because they also knew that the artificially created need to combat the crisis they'd created would be the only thing that could get the nation-states of Europe to accept the total financial and economic union that was the aim from the very start. But in a classic illustration of the best-laid plans of mice and men problem, they clearly didn't expect what was meant to be a manageable, benevolent currency crisis to get all tangled up with the financial nuclear blast of a mega-debt crisis. I expect you're already aware of the trick. The only thing that's new here is my suspicion that the Europhiles may have decided not to wait for the crisis to strike a country the size of Italy or Spain, somewhere, as the phrase goes, too big to bail. Instead, they picked on little Cyprus with the deliberate intention of destroying its economy, because then they can point to the chaos they've created and use it to frighten everyone else into accepting complete fiscal union. Job done from their perspective. If that's a bit too conspiratorial for you, then the only alternative is, of course, simple stupidity. Incompetence on a truly historical scale, courtesy of a gaggle of overeducated intellectuals blinded by their grand utopian vision and the perils of groupthink. He pays you money and he takes your choice. Or when bailout time comes around, the EU takes your money and pays it to a banker of their choice. Now I've got another bit of news for you. News that definitely isn't a theory, but a cold, hard fact. Last month in Strasbourg, the vast majority of MEPs, including the Tories, Lib Dems and Labour, voted to pass the tobacco report, ostensibly a well-meaning initiative to give smaller businesses better access to investment funds. But, as I reported on World at 8 last month, and still unnoticed by the mainstream media, this is a major step towards the goal of giving the EU the power to seize the so-called surplus savings of private individuals in countries like Britain, and use them to invest in growth in countries where there's a savings shortage, including at this rate Cyprus, because they'll have created a chronic savings shortage by stealing them. Of course, they've included in the new rule a cuddly pink fluffy bunny reassurance that it would all be done with incentives. The trouble is that when even cast iron guarantees for savers turn out to be made of smoke and mirrors, it becomes all too clear that in the EU, incentives can come in the form of sticks as well as carrots. So even if the British economy was so strong that the domino effect never hits, and I'm sure that most of my readers are too well informed to believe such rose-tinted bullshit, then the EU is right now working on plans to grab the power to come in at the drop of a hat and raid your bank account in order to help keep one of the unfortunate nations brought to its knees by the single currency from keeling over completely. You've been warned, but don't leave it there. Tell people about it. Warn them too. They may be a little sceptical at present, though after the Cyprus robbery effort, I think you'll find you're pushing on an open door. And whatever they think now, you mark my words, it won't be that long before you can go back to them and say, I told you so.
Thank you so much, Nick. You are so right. Countries and wars are now lost, formed and won on the great god Mammon. World news. Has Syria become a chemical war? The Daily Mail is carrying the story, Russia accuses rebels of using toxic weapons in attack that left 25 dead. Russia's foreign ministry accused Syrian rebels of using chemical weapons to kill 16 people in an attack on a rural area near Aleppo today, calling it an extremely alarming and dangerous development. A spokesman for the Russian Foreign Ministry said, a case of the use of chemical weapons by the armed opposition was recorded early in the morning of March 19th in Aleppo province. We are very seriously concerned by the fact that weapons of mass destruction are falling into the hands of the rebels, which further worsens the situation in Syria and elevates the confrontation in the country to a new level. World Today says the rumoured attack surfaced on Reuters Tuesday following earlier reports last week from Fox News that Israeli intelligence chief says Assad readying chemical weapons. It was over a month ago that World Today first reported that it was alleged the West were preparing a false flag chemical attack in Syria following the hacking of UK defence contractor Britain. The reported emails were declared fake and the false flag operation was strenuously denied by UK, US and Britain officials at the time. Russia is the only country on the world stage that is standing by the Syrian government, as Barack Obama, during his visit to Israel, can only say Syria's use of chemical weapons would be a game-changer and that a red line has been crossed. France and the UK have also joined the chorus sounding the alarm over the use of chemical weapons in Syria and pointing the finger at Assad. So, grain of truth to false flag operation. I guess next month it will be invasion. The reality of it is that the forces that count will use the rebels' use of chemical weapons as an excuse to invade and depose Assad, and then all hell will break loose. The West should stand with Russia on this one to avoid full-scale war. There is more to Islamic sex than husbands and his dead wife's corpse. From the Middle East Research Institute's clip of Moroccan cleric Abdel Bari El Zamzami, we previously learned it is okay for Muslim husbands to have sex with their dead wife's corpse. What we missed at the time was it was also okay for Muslim women to use carrots to pleasure themselves. El Zamzami, a member of the International Union of Muslim Scholars, provided this tidbit of Sharia knowledge in the video interview that was first posted on Arabic site Kifachi.com. World Today comments, don't eat anything with carrots in an Islamic country. You don't know where they've been. Thought for the day, mountains which become molehills. Today's thought concentrates not only on the rise in immigration into the UK, but the shadows it casts on the ordinary people of this country. I don't mean the people who are unaffected by our immigration problem, and who in many ways encourage it, and there are thousands who simply do not want to think of the future, because in their words, how can you solve the problems of the world by yourself? And the ones who unwittingly encourage the problems that spring from employing foreigners and sending what manufacturing we had in this country to the East. Firstly, they hire cheap foreign labour under the excuse that the Brits are lazy and don't want to work, but the hard truth is the basis is money and greed. Rather like sending our prawns to Thailand to be processed out there cheaper and then re-imported back to sell here. It's apparently cheaper than hiring our own to process them on home territory and then sending them by lorry to various retail outlets. Now, if anyone can actually produce the stats on this one, I and the rest of the British National Party would be very interested. As you know, I'm certainly no economist and can accommodate their reticence to help the British tax system. But I would think that the more air miles, fuel and certainly more wages going out, more middlemen, more backhanders, and the fact that nothing, apart from the beginning of this food chain in our waters, involves British labour, gives a slight deficit to this particular plan. No, this awful state of having virtually no manufacturing base in this country any more than is actually British owned or employing British workers on a large scale hasn't come around quickly. It has been a very slow erosion over the last 40 years, ably helped by not only the working man himself, but successive governments and a people who seem only to see trouble when it hits them in the face, or of course have someone to hate like Hitler. For years, even when British-made shoes were the norm, in the late 1970s some clothes manufacturers supplying the high street, as it was then and not the web, went east and imported, amongst other tat, trainers made in either the Philippines or Taiwan, which appealed to the often poor parents of youngsters and the emerging celeb and black cultures. So the first inroads into British luxury goods manufacturing was made. My second husband, now deceased, headed for a company which operated out of Stansted and did import-export to and from Europe and Africa. It was in the late 70s and handled shoes, you know, the huge Gary Glitter sort that looked like cripple boots, to utter a non-PC term, which were made cheaply in Spain, they were imported into the UK and then re-exported out to Nigeria, where the fashion amongst the HIV-infected ladies of the night were those shoes. Now, to my knowledge, the only people who made any money were the Spanish exporters, as they were probably brought in under the radar to the UK. It was the days, I believe, before the Channel. I worked for some time in the early 80s for a man who bought old BT phones, redid them, and then exported them as new BT phones into, again, Nigeria. The only guy to actually make money out of this was the Nigerian importer who sold them on to the government. So we in this country have not been backwards in selling out our own, in a sense. It is in no way that the word globalisation has the same letter to start with as greed. One lovely sentence I remember from the film Alien 2 was when Sigourney Weaver said words along the lines of, "I don't know which is the worst species, alien or us, as you don't see them effing each other over for a dollar." And this is distressingly true. Mankind has a repetitive habit of, just when becoming ultra-civilized, as we like to see ourselves, we will do just about anything, not just to survive, but to profit in an unseemly way over the bodies of our fellow countrymen. So, well on the way to our own destruction in a financial and social sense, the EU waddles in from the sidelines and whoosh, our entire country becomes a safe haven for all the dross and unwanted droves from Europe, and by virtue of even more unwanted masses leaving Africa and the Third World through Europe, we have taken on massive amounts of peoples who have no links with England either through history, culture or religion, and for the most part, if they were not being handed money on arrival, would not think of England as their rightful home destination. So now, during the last 20 years, we have more fodder for the money mill. If our country had stood still for the last 40 years, we would still have mining, steel manufacturing, car manufacturing, cotton and wool mills and carpet manufacturing, wood mills and goods, luxury leather goods, household and kitchen goods, plastics industry and a thriving cottage industry. In the years since the last war, apprenticeships only exist on the television, polytechnics have gone, carpentry and other trades have vanished because all our modern furniture is made in China and other parts of the Far East. Which is, incidentally, resulting in hardship which comes from denuding forests for the indigenous people and the animals who have relied on it for hundreds or thousands of years. Where, quite suddenly, the production of a cheap plastic dining chair, sofa or local wooden artefact becomes cheaper to bring into the country which used to make them from British local wood and leather and gave work to British workers. You tell me the sense behind this in the long term. Even our old art producing industry, which is now almost exclusively operating in China, with artists paid through the night to paint several canvases at a stretch, copying the old European masters or inventing ghastly new wall art for our masses. In fact, the new owners of the Mayfair Hotel in London, who I believe are a wealthy family of Qataris, when they renovated the Mayfair, brought in all the new artwork to be used in that hotel from China, not the UK. You'll find that in most countries of the world this would not be allowed to happen. Even if the owner was allowed to be foreign, which is unlikely out of Europe, he would not be allowed to have foreign objets d'art brought into that country. I did learn a horrendous fact yesterday, gleaned from one of our officers from a mechanic that works in a local garage down south, that when most Polish workers arrive in Blighty, albeit already in predetermined jobs and homes, they are given £2,000 towards a car plus a year's free exemption from road tax. Now, on a personal level, I find that insulting. I've worked most of my life and have had to give up my car because of the finances involved in keeping a car on the road. My youngest son has just saved enough for a car and is finding the road tax a real strain, even though he's working. Not for him and thousands like him any help at all in getting a car, finding a job and having a home. The ridiculous business of the Eastern European scam on our child benefit system is well known and tolerated by us. We actually give newcomers all this when we, as parents and as a people, cannot help our own in their own country. It is almost blasphemous in its awfulness. It is also well known for years to Asian and African immigrants that the UK is the land of milk, honey, mobile phones and cars. You look at any fairly new immigrant and they're always driving a new upmarket car and have the latest in mobile phones, even though they may well be on our benefit system. Do you really think that if the average Muslim paedophile groomer hadn't been able to get a home or homes, operate some sort of business, bring or marry in a host of relations, acquired money for cars and travel, and settled near a large white community, he would have been able to carry out his trade for over 30 years. He's been assisted in this by us, our councils, our governments, and our police force and media. Not all his money comes from illegal drug smuggling, pimping, or taxi ranks, or corner or kebab shops. Most of these people come in without anything at all. They depend on the Muslim network and the British government, in place at that time, because they're all as bad as each other. It is by allowing such people into this country in the first place that we are not, as the media say, enriching our society. We are denigrating it and making it possible for the next generations of these groomers to do exactly what they're doing now, carrying on the family business. Another person who should be shot for changing the face of certain parts of England, namely Hampshire, is Joanna Lumley. There are reports of an increasing number of Nepalese infiltrating, or rather further enriching, parts of the region. In Aldershot, I have it on very good faith from a resident that if you go into the main Aldershot town after 5 o'clock at night, you take your life in your hands if you are white. They've taken over the entire centre of that town. They have their own pubs, clubs and eating holes, their own taxis, and whole gangs of their youth wander around as if they're in the foothills of Kathmandu. Now, I'm sure if the average Brit thinks of a Gurkha, he thinks either of a well-honed, loyal mercenary soldier or a bloke who guides other blokes up mountains. Well, be that as it may, whole villages have disappeared from Nepal, which is worrying in itself for their economy, but bodes ill for ours, both socially and financially. These people, and I use that term collectively for the Nepalese, don't travel without their nearest and dearest, and I mean all of them. Entire tribes are within this country now, and I'm sure the number, even if they could be collected, would appall even Lumley, who I would hope was thinking along the lines of a few old retired soldiers staying on with their immediate family. Not so. I'm certain many, if not most, of these new Nepalese have never seen the inside of a military academy, nor have their further flung relations. They are, in fact, colonising parts of Hampshire, and there is no way of stopping them doing so, with the Lumley Law on the books and the Human Rights Act, part of which we have adopted into British law. They've taken over local schools, with the result racial bullying has increased from their side, and the language problems are immense. You can leave out the learning factor for some years. Most of their young women are pregnant, thus a tremendous strain on the NHS hospitals locally. They have spread out to the suburbs, and even the most remote small village has a sodding Nepalese takeaway, which the locals use in their ignorance. So once again, we are fanning the flames of enrichment to our own detriment. Many pubs in Hampshire have become Nepalese pubs. Unlike the Muslims, the Nepalese drink. And the bear and staff is fast becoming the slant-eyed yellow idol. They're not a gentle, harmless people. They are a hard-headed, hill and mountain tribal people, and do not adapt to the British way of life at all. Nepal and we would be better off returning them, with their very nice pensions, if ex-army, to live in their own habitat and enrich their own country, not our country. There are so many aspects that are bad from our enrichment or enslavement that are just too numerous to mention in detail. M&S seem to have given its entire shoe industry over to China. They're not that cheap. You need left and right foot markings because they all look like the same foot and should all be marked for the Bound Feet Brigade. And the plastic leather is as hard as a bullet. All our cheaper clothes are made with toxic dark dyes and should be washed before wearing. But once they are, they fall to pieces. Plastic Chinese bags are a fortune, and the Indian-made leather from tortured cows are even more so over here. The reptile bags and shoes advertised are a horror show on their own, and anyone buying or encouraging this trade should be shot. As for the cat and dog collars on cheap anoraks, just the same. If a country like Britain cannot or will not supply materials like this, there is a reason. It is illegal and unnecessary. Foreign-made clothes especially are cheaply made, thus the so-called trimming will be even cheaper. The lust for cheap throwaway clothes in this country has ruined our own clothes manufacturing base and is fast killing snakes, lizards and crocodiles who are already on the endangered lists. Hell, if the poor old elephant was up on the fashion industry list along with the Chinese remedy for little pricks, the elephant would have been killed off years ago. We must all take the blame for this shift in industry and manufacturing during the last few decades. greed for cheap imports, a lack of respect for our own people, and an even greedier generation of enrichment lovers who simply ignore the fact that immigration, whilst it may not be a bad thing small and short term, is a disaster for any country in the long term. It is a huge wheel of greed and money, ever evolving in a decreasing circle of decline for local people, businesses, education and public services. Our own people and very early immigrants to this country are and will be suffering more in the future. It will not be the Asian, African, Nepalese or Eastern European newcomer who will suffer. It will be us and our children's children. If we don't at least for the next 20 years try to unite and think as one people. Not a series of money-grubbing and increasingly bereft population who would rather give an accolade to a reduced price of a pint of beer than have laws passed stopping all future immigration entirely. Who would rather watch a TV reality show than actually do something to help his country. And the resultant colonisation which is already well established. Who would rather buy cheap and foreign than bring back some form of pride back to the motherland. It is some of our own people, as well as out-of-date laws, that are ruining this country. Why do these, our own people, still call themselves British? Because you know they're not. They're in a new world of absolute selfishness and blindness. They form none of the solution and part of the problem for our country and the British National Party. Or in the words of Sigourney, you don't see them effing each other over for a dollar. And finally, with this force I thee wed. Jedi Knights could soon make Scotland their intergalactic wedding hub, Presbyterians have predicted. It's been reported in the Telegraph that this claim by the Free Church of Scotland raises the prospect of English Star Wars enthusiasts flocking, or possibly flying, to Gretna Green for ceremonies complete with guards of honour wielding lightsabers instead of swords. Other groups which could soon be in line to host weddings in Scotland include the Flat Earth Society, which rejects evidence that the world is round, a view once held by the Christian Church and indeed by the civilised world as it was then. The Church's predictions came as it launched an attack on plans by the First Minister, Alex Salmond, for a new class of belief ceremonies alongside traditional religious and civil weddings. The Scottish Government is currently attempting to overhaul the marriage laws north of the border, primarily to introduce same-sex marriage. But the bill would also have to include a wider update of matrimonial laws, including plans to create a third way to get married, through so-called belief ceremonies to accommodate those who do not believe in a deity, but do promote a belief system. This presenter states, obviously Salmond is a Marxist and doing his best to undermine the Christian Church in Scotland. To get married should still be a fairly serious business unless undertaken by film stars or celebs. If he has his way, perhaps jumping over a fire holding hands will suffice, but I'd love to see how this belief system handles divorce. You've been listening to The World at Eight. I am Lynn Mozar, and I and the team at World at Eight and Radio Britain wish you all a very happy and a very safe and a very warm weekend.